it was so funny. I was like, Taylor, you're frozen.
Everyone, welcome back to the Time Travelers Book Club. This month we read our time travel book, which was The 7.5 Deaths of Evelyn Hardcastle by Stuart Turton. And I don't know if I'm saying his last name right, but it always feels weird when I say it. Turton.
I think, yeah, if anyone has suggestions, let us know. But yeah. I think that's good.
Stuart, if you want to let us know, drop a line. So I'll just give you a little overview of the book. So it's set, I keep telling people, it's like set in Downton Abbey type of manor home, and they're throwing a big masquerade with all of these guests. And so our main character at the beginning, we don't know his name, but he wakes up in a body that isn't his, with, you know, thoughts and a life that isn't his. And every day he wakes up in a different body, and he has to solve the death of Evelyn Hardcastle, who is the daughter of the owners of this house. So that's the mystery. And yeah, what do you think, Mary Kelly?
And it's funny that you said Downton Abbey, because I, the house Blackheath, right?
Yes.
Manor house winner. Mm-hmm. I immediately pictured in like a Knives Out sort of house, like the movie. Mm-hmm. With all the people too, it had that feel like for me.
Yeah, very Knives Out.
Very Knives Out. So that's kind of like the vibe, you know, a real like whodunit. I was surprised like that we started out with a male narrator, because with the title, I thought maybe we were gonna jump right to Evelyn Hardcastle, but we didn't. And that kind of is, you know, the main point of the story and how it turns out. But I think the number one thing, like, this book reminded me also was Agatha Christie. It is very, it's a book that probably would do great with a second read through, because there's so many clues, I feel like, throughout, you know, every chapter. And I think that if you went back, you would really benefit from getting like, oh my gosh, I see it now. It's all coming together a little bit clearly, or more clear, because there's definitely a lot of going on. There's a lot of characters. There's a lot of like inhabiting other characters. So there's a lot of things that you need to pay attention to. But I think that's a real testament to a good author, because, you know, it definitely makes sense, but it's just such a good story that you can't help but, you know, want to keep reading it.
Absolutely. Like, and I love, like, I'll show you, I love a book with a map at the beginning, you know. I also like something that really immediately drew me in is that we open the book with this invitation to the masquerade that they're having. And it's kind of like getting a cast of characters before you're reading a play or something like that. So it was really interesting to go back and, like, the book opens with our main character in the forest, and he watches someone get shot. And then somebody gives him a creepy like compass that has initials on it. So I immediately went to this list and I was like, okay, whose initials are it?
I was just going to say, that's why I love having that reference, so you can go back to it. So you don't really miss that important stuff. You always have that point of reference. And also, although I am a dedicated ebook reader, it's nice to have the paper copy in that.
Yeah. I mean, I just thought it was really interesting. One thing I did really like is that every single character has a very distinct personality. Mm-hmm. And whenever our main character jumps into somebody else's body, he kind of adopts their personality a little bit.
That was something that I wanted to mention too, because I think that learning these new personalities starts to take over him. So instead of trying to solve the murder, you know, he's, you know, kind of coping, you know, with new personalities. Who is this person? What am I doing? So essentially he has to become a new person to solve this murder. Yeah. And I think that's where the story isn't just so much, you know, what is the end game? What's the murder? Who murdered someone? But you know, like, who are these people, you know, that are also, you know, in this world?
Right, exactly. And like, you know, I thought it was very interesting that not only do you have these characters who, it's over the span of 8 days, he has to repeat the day 8 times in different people, but there's also other characters, like there's the plague doctor and the footman and that woman. And so,
And those characters are so vivid. I kept coming back to the plague doctor in particular, like when they describe him, it really sets the tone. It sets like the whole like scene. So you really feel like you're in the action. You're there, you're with them. You're wondering who's going to pop up next.
Yeah. I got kind of confused it was like the chapters are very short. So it was something like the 12th chapter when he got told the rules by that woman.
Oh, and yeah.
Like every time the person that you are currently falls asleep, you become this other character. And it was a little confusing at that point, but I thought it was kind of interesting.
Yeah. And I mean, just with the sheer amount of major and minor characters, you're always like, is this person going to be like is this person integral to the action, or is it just kind of someone that's like ephemeral and like kind of like moves in and out? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's definitely like a book that you want to dedicate to. It's not something that's just going to like.
This isn't like a casual read.
It's not a casual read, and it's not a short read. It's definitely a more in-depth, I want to say like world building, but you know what I mean? Like something that really you get immersed in.
Absolutely. And like, I wouldn't necessarily say that we were reliving the same day every day. It was like Groundhog Day, but it was not kind of not time travel-y for me. What do you think?
I don't think that you feel like very specifically that it is a certain time period. I wasn't like, oh, this is 1742. Like the time is really like not, the time period is not really like essential for the book, and it's not really like its own sort of character or something like that. And like you said, we are reliving the same day, but it doesn't feel, I don't know, it didn't feel like that. But yeah, I think that as far as time travel goes, not really so much.
It kind of felt like Blackheath Manor and the grounds were like a liminal space where like time didn't exist.
That's putting it perfectly. Thank you for
You're welcome.
Putting words to my thoughts.
But it was just like, it was really interesting how, he could relive the day. And like, as he relived the day, he was in other places at once. So he could talk to himself in the future and the past, which was really weird. Yeah. Because it was still all the same day.
It almost is like, yeah, there's a complete, like you have to like suspend your ideas of what time is because it's not really important anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, like I said, I at the beginning I thought it was like maybe Downton Abbey-ish, but then I'm like, oh, like the cover's kind of art deco, is it like 1920s?
Well, I thought that it was going to be like you said, like something 1920s. It felt very like flapper or and then I actually didn't know what the book was about at all, so I kind of went into it blind, and I was like, oh, okay, like it was really surprising. So
yeah, and I mean it's not, definitely not like the early 1800s or anything, because like they have a carriage house where all the horses and carriages are kept, but when he tries to leave one time as one character, they give him a car.
Yeah.
And he's like, well, I don't know about this.
Because whenever I hear manor, right, like saw the like masquerade invitation, I think like Jane Austen, I think like
Manor
or something like that. But I don't think it was that time period. That's why I thought like after the car, like Knives Out with the like old timey car, which I don't know.
I was very much like when I'm reading a mystery, I'm like trying to solve the mystery before it's solved in the book.
Yeah. So
I started this notebook and I would like go through each day or whatever. Obviously you can't do that because eventually it starts jumping between days, but I started like writing down clues, but I had read like the first chapter and I had like 5 pages written and I'm like, I can't keep doing this.
Yeah. And that's, again, I think that's definitely like the where the second read through will feel like a lot clearer, because there's just so much going on the first one. Like it's like, oh my God, I totally forgot about that. So we have to totally shift who I thought did it, who I thought, what I thought was going on. So,
it's definitely an interesting book, and it's definitely very engaging, and like the imagery in it is superb. I really am enjoying it.
Very compelling. Yeah.
And I have to keep reading this book, but then I'm like, how much can I take? Because it's thick. Like, this is a thick book. It's a thick boy. It's long.
We've read some short ones, but this one was some dedicated time and space. But I don't think I would have picked it up on my own. So that's I think that's the point of why we do some of these. So I am glad I read it.
Yeah, it's definitely, like, I started reading it and I was like, oh, I know exactly who to recommend this book to. Like, I recommended it to my coworker, Carol, and I recommended it to my grandmother, and I recommended it to basically anyone I know who likes a historical fiction or a mystery.
I definitely will recommend this book. It's a good, you know, reader's advisory pick. I think it has, like, a lot of mystery or thriller has, like maybe violent or sexual parts or like is too, you know, whatever. This is something I feel comfortable recommending across the board. You know, like I do with like Ruth Ware, I've got like some of that. Agatha Christie, anyone that's a fan of those sort of things. Also, you know, Downton Abbey, you know, BBC. I think that people would really enjoy it too. I don't think don't let the length, you know, turn you off. I think this would be a really good book. Like I said, for anyone, like you said, and we said, for fans of those genres. I always like when I read a book and I feel like really comfortable being like, you know, if someone asked me for a recommendation, like I feel really comfortable in, you know, and say, hey, I think I like this, you know, I feel comfortable giving you this. So
I always kind of get, I don't know about you, but when people are like, recommend me a book, I'm like, what do you like or whatever? Like, I don't know.
That's so broad.
But this is, you're right. This is one that I'd feel like comfortable because I feel like it spans genres almost. Yeah.
I think, and I read somewhere too, there is like a fantasy dystopian aspect to it too. So, you know, fans of science fiction, I would give this a try. You know, narrative fiction, literary fiction, I think it really checks all the boxes for you know, for a good pick, for a recommendation. Be a good book club pick, because there's a lot you could probably, you could like split it into a few sessions, because there's a lot to talk about.
I'm kind of like, well, what do we talk about? There's so much, like,
and I think that the author too left a lot of it ambiguous for the reader to come up with an explanation or come up with their own, you know, kind of conclusions, which I always enjoy, because, you know, it can change, you know, from reading it from one time to the next.
Right, exactly. And I'd be interested to, you know, like you said, read it again, kind of knowing what I know now, because when you first start the book, you're kind of like, what's happening? Does he have amnesia? Like, he like, knows that this is a body that's not his, but he also is like, I don't know.
What's going on?
Yeah. And I really liked how he kind of questioned, the first character he's in is a doctor, but he's also kind of like a drug dealer type of guy. And he's like, is this the kind of person I am? Like, I am not to this. And I think it's very interesting how, you know, inside of being in these bodies, he definitely has his own distinct personality that he's trying to stick to.
So I think overall, you know, the pacing is very good. The precise clues that are left. I definitely felt, if not, it was a time travel book, I definitely felt I was myself transported to their world. So I will blur the lines of the purpose of the book club and say that, yes, for that reason, I believe it was a time travel book.
I
really enjoyed it, so.
Yeah, me too. And I definitely, like I said, would recommend this, and I would reread it. I'd be interested in listening to the audiobook, because if I was casting the audiobook, I would have each person be a different voice.
That would be a, that would be definitely worth checking out, because I think that it would be a lot clearer if you could physically, like, hear, you know, auditorily hear, you know, the changes in the narrative.
especially when he like goes to sleep as one character and wakes up as another. I feel like that'd be an interesting transition.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, thanks for joining us for this was June time travel. I believe this is the year anniversary of the time travel book club. So
I think you're right. Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary, Taylor. And it's been a year. It's been a wild ride. So what is July's pick, Fed?
July's pick is The Night Circus by Erin Morgenstern. And we'll be back with that on the 20th of July.
That sounds amazing. I will see you then.
All right, perfect. And we'll see you guys then. Bye.
Bye.